So far, we've looked at the case where multiple gears were all of the same size in a line, and we saw that there was a one-to-one relationship there. And then we looked at the case where we had multiple different gears connected together, and we saw that, in fact, the middle gear didn't play a part. In these two cases, the middle gears only pushed the motion down the line. But this might mean that if the middle gear doesn't count, the only thing that matters is the beginning and end. And so how do we get these larger gear ratios of gearing up and gearing down? Well, the trick there is actually to put two gears onto the same axle. Here, each gear is on a separate axle. So for instance, if we have an axle here and we have a gear on it connected to, say, another gear, we can add a third gear along that same axle as that second gear. And what happens is, since they're attached on the same axle, one rotation for this back gear will move this little gear one rotation as well. So there's actually a one-to-one relationship between those two. And then by combining extra gears onto that front one, we can start to build up gear trains that exceed the size, the ratios of the gears that we actually already have. So, for instance, I have one of those built right here. And so what we can see is on the left, which is where the red is connected, I've built one where there is a 8 gear on the back connected to a 40. That 40 has an axle that goes straight through to the front, where I have a second 8, and that 8 is connected up to a 40 on the front here. So let's draw that out. Actually, it looks exactly like this here, where I have, starting from the front, I have a little 8-tooth gear in the back. That's connected up to a large 40. That 40 comes back through the front, connecting up to an 8, which is connected to another 40 here on the front. So what does the math look like here? Well, we do the exact same sort of ratios between the two. In the back, it's an 8 to 40. And in the front, it's also an 8 to 40. If we multiply these out, we can actually first reduce them down into two 1x5s, which then indicates that it's a 1 to 25 ratio. Unlike in this case, nothing cancels out, and so instead, the two gear ratios multiply together to form an even larger result. So let's test that out. Let's see if this is indeed a 1 to 25 relationship with the 8 to 40 in the back and another 8 to 40 in the front. So I'll turn this red crank 25 times, and we should see the yellow on the final gear go around once. So here we go. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25. And here we are back at the starting point where we were, 25 times on this, one time on that, and indeed this relationship holds. So this means that we can then take any sort of sequence of gears and calculate as it moves from axle to axle what that relationship sort of is. So looking at the input and wondering what the output might be. And so if we think of this as A, B, C, D, and so on, we have an A to B multiplied by a B to C multiplied by a C to D, and then up here an E to F, F to G, G to H, H to I, and back down here, J to K, K to L, L to M, M to N, and N to O. And as we do out this entire multiplication, all of the middle gears cancel out, which then results in an A to D, this first and last of the first sequence, an E to I, first and last of the second sequence, and a J to O, the first and last of this sequence. And this total value will indicate the ratio from the first to last gear. This then finally means that you can get into much more complex situations, such as this gear contraption that I've made, where you can actually start to calculate the relationship between the inputs and the outputs over multiple layers of different types of gears.